Ethan, what's your objective? What's your ultimate objective?
Your life will always matter more to me than my own. None of our lives can matter more than this mission. I can't accept that. Welcome back to Should You Watch This with the Popcorn Priest, a weekly podcast where movie enthusiasts, ex-movie theater projectionists, new and old friends take the time to talk about a movie that we just watched and answer that very question, should or shouldn't you watch this? It was our mission, and we chose to accept it. We're finishing our mission to watch all of the Mission Impossible films, including the newest one that's out in theaters currently right now, Mission Impossible: Dead Reckoning Part 1.
Ethan, I understand you're upset.
I'm not upset. You wanted me to listen. This is me listening.
This mission is gonna cost you dearly. And the world's gonna be coming after you.
Hang on!
Mission Impossible: Dead Reckoning, July 12th.
All right, man. Welcome back. Am I IMF veteran Dan Sekulich? We're here to finish Dead Reckoning.
I have to correct you because technically, and I don't know where all has this, but if you look on IMDb, it's actually Mission : Impossible - Dead Reckoning Part 1.
Yeah, you're right. I mean, listen, it's a reoccurring joke for my whole career as the Popcorn Priest. I think it's hilarious saying colon for the colon because it's like I'm a 2-year-old and like butt humor. So yeah, you're right. There is not as many colons, but I like it's funny to me. So. But thank you for correcting me on the show. That's really nice.
You got it.
Thanks. All right. As you know, go listen to our part one, non-spoilery. There's a couple of sprinklings of spoilers,
but not really.
Not too bad. But this is where we're going to get into spoilers. So if you haven't seen Mission Impossible: Dead Reckoning Part 1, do so now. Go to the theater. Experience it in the biggest screen possible, as it will be the best experience you can have with this film. And then come back and join us for this week's review. Let's jump right into trivia.
Yeah.
Let me tell you something, Pandeo.
This film is in theaters currently, so there's not as much lore and trivia out there, but I found some good ones. We did some extra research here at Should You Watch This, and here's what I found. When Ethan and Grace meet for the first time at the airport, Tom Cruise insisted on performing the magic trick with the two halves of the key practically. Despite numerous failed attempts, the desired effect was ultimately achieved in camera with little to no visual effects. I don't know what that means. That's kind of a little sketchy there, but I believe that Tom Cruise probably spent all of his nights in front of a mirror with a key, like perfecting like sleight of hand magic so that he could do it in camera.
Yeah, look, we know that he's a certified pilot for both a helicopter as well as multiple planes.
Oh yeah, I'll get into that too. I looked that up. It'll surprise you.
Yeah, we know that he's certified jumping out of planes, right?
Correct.
So
correct.
I can imagine that he's gone to magic camp and also is now certified as a magician.
Yes,
from magic
dude.
Camp.
I bet he spent so many hours watching like magic tutorials so that he
could
do it.
The man practiced so much that he was able to hold his breath for 6 minutes.
Which is insane. We talked a little bit about this last week about the COVID-19 issues that plagued the shoot of this movie, and filming started in this is what I was trying to say last week about how it could affect the budget so much. So filming started in Venice on the same day Northern Italy locked down for COVID-19. Production was hastily moved to Rome, only to be shut down again while they were there. So each time they would move, and it was like it was just constant delays. I can't imagine it not being demoralizing as a crew, as the director. It's just like, oh man, we got to wait again.
Just with the utter confusion and chaos and, you know, myths and disinformation and, mm-hmm. and the way that COVID-19 turned into a complete political shit show, that also had to be discouraging, because during difficult times, like a depression or when there are economic woes, there's three things that actually increase in basically revenue, mm-hmm. which is alcohol sales, sex industry, and movie, mm-hmm. because people need it. When times are tough, people need it. And so you mentioned last week, and we mentioned on the podcast that Top Gun Maverick, by most accounts, saved the industry. And so this was definitely a sad one, especially with some of the things you laid out in last week. It's definitely a sad one that this one got delayed so much and it got impacted so much because of COVID-19.
Yeah, we talked about the budget and the box office haul so far is at almost $400 million. I would imagine, well, and combined with what happened with it getting kicked out of the IMAX theaters because of Oppenheimer, like, I bet it would be over $500 million right now easily, had not Easy. All those things happened to it.
Agreed. And I will say, I at the end of last week, I mentioned my experience here with my first theater. I know there in the United States, everybody going to Barbie is dressing in pink and
yeah.
like it's the same thing here.
Really? That's insane.
Crazy.
It's an insane. Crazy. It's insane. The internet is weird. It does weird things to people. Makes them go do weird stuff.
Amen to that.
Here's another tidbit about the COVID-19 stuff. And I thought this was so awesome. And I kind of wish it would have happened to me during COVID. So this is what happened to Tom Cruise and McQuarrie. One of the biggest movie stars in the world and his longtime director holed up together while shooting a behemoth action blockbuster. Thanks to the intervention of COVID-19, quote, we'd wake up in the morning. We'd meet in the living room for breakfast. We'd talk about the movie. We would drive to work in the car together. We'd work all day. And then we'd ride back to the apartment together at the end of the night. And that was our life.
Wow.
Can you imagine like just living with Tom Cruise for like 6 months?
If there's one person that I think you would want to, it's probably him.
Yeah.
Because not only does he know how to do everything, he's also a strange duck by all accounts in his personal life.
Correct. And it would just be fascinating to just hang out with them. Be like,
yeah,
whatever you want to do, Tom, what's next on your agenda? I want to just do what you're doing.
Do you think he ever sleeps?
I mean, I've seen him in interviews that he watches a movie. He tries his best. Like, it's his goal to watch a movie a day. That's how much he loves movies. So like, I don't know. I would love to know what his like sleep schedule's like, what his morning routine is like, what, you know, what he does at night to get ready to sleep. What,
brother, he is 60 years old. Like, how?
I don't know. That's what I'm saying. I want to know all of his secrets. I want to know if there's witchcraft involved. I want to know if he's, you know, wiping gypsy tears on his skins. Like, what is he doing? I want all of it. It would just be dope. If there was like a sweepstakes to win a week with Tom Cruise, I would enter it a million times.
You know what? Maybe the answer is right under our noses and we actually make fun of him for it. Maybe Scientology is the answer.
I mean, maybe we need to join.
Maybe. Maybe. I might have to look into that.
Start going to some meetings. But there's probably some stuff that we don't get in the low ranks of Scientology. You got to get right to the high areas to unlock some of the cool things that we wouldn't be able to see.
You're right. I need to level up fast.
Level it up. All right. Last two trivia points. I thought this was fun. Multiple languages for the same actor for the voiceovers. So Palm Clementife, dubbed herself in French because she speaks French. I think that's so cool. If you were a French speaker, being able to hear her voice as the dubbed actor would be the best.
That is something that I should have brought up last week, and I perfect segue.
So oh, yeah.
That is one thing that is unique here is they have two different options, Legendado, which is subtitles in Portuguese, or they have Dublado, which is dubbed Portuguese. Oh. And some those that can handle the subtitles absolutely prefer. It just sounds off. And I've watched quite a few movies dubbed just in our home with Dublado, and it's terrible, man. It takes away from it so much. Unfortunately.
Yeah, imagine having some weird
Tom
actor.
Cruise. Yeah, Tom Cruise delivers a specific performance because, you know, he's great because he's Tom Cruise. And that goes with how he delivers a specific line. And when another actor dubs that, it doesn't correlate. And so a lot gets lost. And so we obviously went and saw the Legendado option.
Awesome. Okay, that's good.
Yeah.
And for your wife, I know she speaks English. Is that distracting for her, or she prefers it that way?
She also prefers it that way. I'm sure it's not the easiest thing to do, especially in a fast moving and a long movie like this.
True.
I'm sure it's a little more challenging because the difficulty, and you know this because you speak a second language. Now your Spanish is strong because you've been speaking it from a very young age because your father teaches it. But when you speak a second language, like for me, I speak a fair amount of Portuguese, but a conversation is difficult if somebody goes fast and long, because the second I lose it, you can't catch back up.
Yeah.
And so that can be very, very challenging.
Yeah, you get hung up on one word and then
you're lost.
10 words ahead of you and you're like, oh, freak, I don't know what you're talking about anymore.
It happens to me often. Now, like I said, you're a little more advanced and I've continued to improve, but it still happens to me in most of my conversations if I conversate long enough.
Yeah. Well, you're lucky because anyone learning a second language, having that immersion, like being in the place where they speak it all the time. I know you speak English there with your family, but like you're around it all the time. So that's the best way to learn a language.
Yeah, no, it is. I will tell you though, you know, I came out here in March of 2020 and you brought up COVID-19 multiple times. Imagine trying to learn a second language by conversing with people through masks.
Oh my gosh, that sounds like a nightmare, dude.
Yeah, so my first year and a half, that's what I had to do. And so that really put me behind in my learning curve.
That's an interesting point.
Because you don't hear the full enunciation, you're not seeing how they're forming their words. But believe it or not, we actually watch other people's mouths a lot more than you realize when you speak.
That's interesting.
Yeah.
Well, that made your movie theater story that much more interesting.
Yeah, absolutely.
All right, last trivia point, and this blew my mind. The production was looking for a train. So there's a huge train sequence in the film. For a train bridge that would be scheduled for destruction to blow it up on screen, they found one in Poland until it turned out it had historical value after all. There was a misunderstanding about it being destined to be destroyed as well as strong opposition to the idea from the locals. So they headed back to the U.S. and built a bridge from scratch. And they also built an entire full functioning train because no one would let them blow up a train. So they had to build the bridge to explode in real and then a full train, a working train that they exploded and destroyed and crashed.
I mean, look at it. It probably, you've got to admit that the train scene was incredible.
I would argue cooler than the motor, as cool as the motorcycle scene is in IMAX, seeing it in a giant, you know, three-story screen, it's super impressive. The train sequence has so much more depth to it that it's pretty cool.
We just recorded a episode on Bullet Train.
Correct.
Which was true to the title. And I actually enjoyed this train sequence better than that.
Oh, for sure. And I'm not going to spoil our review of Bullet Train, but this is much better than that sequence. in a lot of different ways. But yeah, that pod will come out later. But yeah, it's pretty great. We're ready for beefs, man. Get your beefs on deck.
Where's the beef? Hey, where's the beef?
All right, I have three beefs with... not the film in general, but three beefs surrounding the film. Do you want me to tell you mine before you tell me yours?
Yes.
Okay. During an interview, and this, I don't even know if I'm going to be able to get through this. Okay. During an interview with Savannah Guthrie in the long-running TV show Today, Tom Cruise said that this movie and Mission Impossible Dead Reckoning Part 2, which will be coming out next year, will be his final portrayal as Ethan Hunt, as well as the final main installment of Mission Impossible.
No, I can't see it.
So here's the thing. I'm not going to spoil anything for John Wick 4, but they all, even before the movie came out, the directors and the people working on it were like, hey, they're creating a whole world building with a TV show and a spinoff movie. And they're like, we're done with John Wick, we're going to kind of explore all these other options. And like, they just announced that they're going to make a John Wick 5. And they say, the executives are quoted as saying, it's not for a cash grab, but they're okay. Really interested in making a John Wick 5. So I'm on your side where you were saying, I don't think so. I mean,
nah.
If the last one gets as much buzz as I think it will, I mean, never say never. But it's sad to hear that from his mouth. I mean, Tom Cruise isn't a guy. He's not a guy that it's going to, like, give lip service, dude. He's probably serious.
He's the GOAT for a reason. And one of those reasons are that he does his own stunts. And we've alluded to it multiple times. He's 60 years old. Like, how much longer can he honestly do it at this level? Because if he can't do the character justice, I feel like he's the type of person that would say no mas.
I agree, because he's so passionate about creating a product for the audience that if he is in any way compromising to that goal, that end product, he just will probably say no.
Which is why it's crazy. And we heard some of the reviews was specific to Tom Cruise in some of his personal beliefs. But I don't know if there's many actors that are motivated by as much by the audience as Tom Cruise is.
Like, yeah.
His intentions are all geared toward and motivated by the audience. And I think that's really great.
I've heard him say in interviews, like, he loves going to movies with audiences. I don't know how he pulls that off, but maybe he does. I'm always looking around now if there's some guy in a hat that looks like Tom Cruise, because I'm going to go talk to him if he's ever in my theater. Yeah.
Can I bring up a late trivia?
Yes. Do you have one?
I do. And it's, do you remember when we talked about Bob?
Oh yeah.
There was another Bob in this.
There
and
was.
In Top Gun Maverick, the one character's name is Bob. But in this one, I can't remember. And
I remember hearing it.
To it going, yeah. And thinking, oh, I got to bring that up on the pod. And I can't remember it, but I know that once again, he paid homage to Bob.
Yeah. I do remember Simon Pegg saying, Bob's your uncle. But I think there was another.
Yeah.
There's another Bob reference that's more, not just a passing, you know, phrase. And I remember hearing it. And I was like, oh, there it is. And then I just, you know, moved on. But
yeah, like I think he introduced himself as as Bob something. Anyways, I wanted to make sure that I brought that up as I thought it, because it is so cool how he finds a way to do it.
Yeah. And that's like, this is going to be on my rewatchable list. It's fun to look for those things on a second and third viewing.
Agreed.
All right. My last two beefs. Then this in no way reflects on Palm Clementine's acting ability, because she's great. I love that she's super cool looking, and her affectation and all those things. Her action stunt stuff is really great. But this bothered me. I don't know if it bothered you, but according to her, it was confirmed that her character's white makeup and black teardrop design was her idea. And I think they should have not done that. I did not like it.
Yeah. It just didn't fit.
It felt like a James Bond type thing. Like a villain would wear some weird makeup just to like stand out. And I was like, nope, I don't like it. And now I know why, because it was felt her idea. Silly. Like, you're not the director. I think the director was just like placating her, because she probably went through such a horrible experience in that fight scene in the alleyway, that he's like, okay, yeah, you can wear white makeup if you want.
Boy, it's funny that you say that, because it wasn't as in my face until you just said it, but I always felt there was something off with the makeup, and I couldn't understand why they had it either. Like, if it was a group like that had a bunch of misfits, yeah, but this is, we're talking about an extraordinarily professional and high dollar, you know, organizations here from all points. So yeah, I'm with you.
Good. Yeah. Beef. Yeah. I feel like the character like that wouldn't draw that much attention to herself.
Agreed. And it felt gimmicky, and it took just a little bit away from what happened to her at the end, which I know we're in spoiler zone.
Yeah.
But that was a moment where I was like, ugh, I kind of wish that she could continue to
Do you
find
think she's
vindication.
Dead? Do you think she's actually dead? Okay.
I do.
There's a little ambiguity at the end, but yeah, it seems pretty definitive that her character is dead.
Do you think Ilsa Faust is dead?
Yeah, I do. I was joking. I don't want to listen. In this world, okay, please just know that I'm a nice guy. I don't hate people, okay? I like people. I like nice people. I like Rebecca Ferguson. She's a nice lady, probably. I've never met her in real life, but I joked with my buddy that it was that Leonardo DiCaprio. I thought it was Leonardo DiCaprio syndrome, where Ethan Hunt needed a younger lady, a more attractive lady. So he just killed the one off in the story so he could have somebody else. Obviously, that's not the case, because I think they're about the same age. But Haley seems younger. I don't know why, to me.
Yeah, but way younger.
But I think they're the same age, within.
You think?
Yeah, I think they're like exactly the same age. And in fact, I think Rebecca Ferguson might be younger, but it doesn't appear that way to me. So that was my joke.
Yeah,
not a good joke.
Aunt Becca.
All right, here's my last beef, and this is a beef with the internet. Okay, so there's a photo circling the internet that shows three Tom Cruise lookalikes, and that the caption is that they're all his stunt doubles. Okay. This is false, and it is AI generated. And just a reminder, Tom does all his own stunts. He does not need a stunt guy that looks like him, because he is the guy that does the stunts. Okay. So it's a fake image. Yeah. Don't believe it. When you see it, you can look it up. It's AI generated, and they kind of don't look that great anyway. So that's my beef.
To be clear, though, like, there might be some reshoots that are done as maybe a couple of cutaways in a scene that has stunts in it.
Oh,
but
yeah.
The actual stunt is done by Tom Cruise. Maybe some of the reshoots are probably done by a double, because Tom's a busy guy.
If it's like some guy run, you know, walking down the street and you only see the back of his head, and they just need another angle. Yeah. We're not sullying Tom's time with that dumb scene. Okay. He doesn't need to be in there. That's fine.
Exactamente. Yep.
All right. Any beefs that you have? I'm opening the beef round table for you.
Yeah, I'm not going to have much. My first beef is, why did it take 7 to get a hot girl in there?
Okay. We've established that. So, I can appreciate that beef.
It's been a consistent beef and mm-hmm. one that's really kind of gnawed at me. Honestly, other than that, I shouldn't say I don't have them go straight into one. I do that almost every episode. So your listeners who know me know that's what I do. But I will say it was just barely too long for me.
Okay.
We talked a little bit that you felt like it wasn't. At one point, I did find myself, and even my wife was the same. We kind of took turns where both of us were trying to stretch a little bit and kind of massage each other for a second, because if you're not a consistent moviegoer, it's not always the most comfortable thing, because sometimes it's like sitting on an airplane. I think that was just a little bit too long, but not by much. But other than that,
There are theaters. I don't know if they exist. I'm sure they do somewhere in Brazil, but there's a lot more. There's the trend in the U.S. is luxury seating, where you've got these big recliners and they have like adjustable headrests and all that kind of stuff. I buy those tickets when I can, but the problem is if you get too comfy, I might just go to sleep.
In certain movies, for sure, I would. That just brings up another question. Since let's go back to this being my first experience.
Okay.
In a movie theater. So you went and saw this in IMAX.
Correct.
I would hope that you went and got some concessions. Yes?
I did. I got more than I needed, and I also smuggled some things. I smuggled some things as well.
What did you smuggle?
So here's, I think I've talked about this one time on the pod, but this is a pro tip. I have two really good pro tips for you. The first one is, I really love if you can get some really tender teriyaki beef jerky and you either like you say, separate it with the peanut butter M&Ms, or you can just toss it right in that popcorn bucket. The meat with the popcorn.
You have said that.
I don't know what that does some real nice things to me, and I really enjoy it. And especially for a 3-hour movie, I need some protein to keep my body going. That's a good pro tip.
I feel like we're going back to one of the reviews again, where the movie came out and touched him.
Yeah, well, this one touched me. The meat,
jerky, and popcorn. Yeah.
Yes.
Okay.
And then the other pro tip, and I mentioned this before, I believe there's this conspiracy out there by Big Soda. They're trying to remove, I don't know what it is. There's the Coke Freestyle machines. They're so delicious. I'm American. I love that sugar. I'm trying to reduce it and reduce my intake. But when I'm at the theater, I have it. Here's the thing. They used to have Mellow Yellow, which, because I can't get Mountain Dew in the theater, for some reason, it's never available. Right. But you can get Mellow Yellow in the Freestyle machines, and they used to have Grape Mellow Yellow, which was a god tier. Okay, they removed the grape flavoring, so the only way you can get it is if you do maybe a fourth part Grape Fanta and then 3 parts Mellow Yellow. You'll thank me later. Just try it, please. Just go try it.
That's a legit pro tip. And I will tell you that you and I have always been Dusky fans, mm-hmm. playing the video games. We don't have it here.
Mountain Dew.
No Mountain Dew.
It's just not even Dr. available.
Pepper. No.
Do you have Costco's?
No, we have a Sam's Club. We go there.
And they don't have Mountain Dew at the Sam's Club's, huh?
No. No. Wow. No, it's definitely regionized for Brazil.
That's a sad day, man.
They have a couple of things.
What soda that's unique to Brazil that you, I know you like Coke, obviously, but like, is there a soda that I couldn't get that you're like, oh, this is pretty legit?
No. I mean, the most.
Thanks. That's very interesting and good for the pod. Thank you. No, there's nothing really.
No, there's, so the one is called Guaraná. And if you go to any shoe, Yeah, if you go to any Brazilian steakhouse, they'll have Guaraná. It'll be in a green can with little cherries on it. And it's good. It's not great. When I get a little bit tired of Coke, and then other than that, they have Fanta, grape and orange. Then they have Pepsi. But okay. they don't exactly dedicate an entire aisle to soda.
Which is wise.
Yeah, I would say so. But I really miss Dr. Pepper. But no, in the Sam's Club, they don't have too much stuff that is directly from America. There are certain things, but not much.
Hmm. Well, there you have it. Can't get the dew in Brazil. Looks like I won't be moving there with you.
No, you won't.
Let's get into puzzles. If your beefs are squashed.
That's it.
All right.
A sphincter says what? What? A sphincter says what? What? Exactly.
All right. This puzzle is not with the movie. It's with a comment that was made back in 2020 when they were talking about the movie coming out in an interview. And it's a puzzle because I'm not sure. I have a theory and I'll tell you what my theory is, but I'm puzzled by what the comment that McQuarrie says. Okay. I'm just going to call him McHugh or Q.
Thank you. Okay.
Because I say it wrong all the time. Back in 2020, in an interview looking back on Jack Reacher, McQuarrie or Q told Empire that he and Cruise had been looking to make a hard R movie together with a very un-Tom character, in quotation marks. And while the two-part mission has taken precedent, they're still planning to make that together under the code name The Gnarly Movie. There's a movie that Cruise and I are talking about doing next, or in some probable next, that Eric, some writer, and I developed together. What has been referred to on the internet as the Gnarly Movie, McHugh teases. It's that movie that they're all asking for and that we want to do. First, they just have to get through the gnarliest movie of all time, which is Mr. Impossible Dead Reckoning Part 2. Do you want me to tell you what I think the gnarly movie is going to be?
You're dang right, and I think I might know, but go ahead.
I think it is a Les Grossman standalone movie.
Yep, that's what I thought you were going to say. Yep.
And I put my money on it, and if that's the case, listen, I don't know if it will be good. I don't know if they can do a Les Grossman movie. Like, I think his character is really funny and great, but I don't know if he can carry a full movie.
I think that's more of like a promotional short film.
Yeah, it's like back in the 90s and early 2000s where SNL alums would go do a movie that was based on a sketch. And it's like, sometimes they could pull it off, but other times
not
it's
very
like,
often, though.
Not great.
They didn't pull it off very, very often. But I'm super interested. But that's exactly where I thought you were going to go is that one. And I know how much you love that character because you guys did a pod on that.
I love Tropic Thunder, dude. What a
Tropic Thunder, so good. Right?
What a unique,
so good
gem that we will never get again.
Never get again, because woke Hollywood.
Any puzzles you have? Anything you were didn't understand or like what's going on here?
Here's just one puzzle. There's a movie that I remember from my childhood because my father had called into a radio station and won a couple of movies. They were on VHS and. One of them was Dirty Dancing. Another was La Bamba.
Okay.
Is Ezi Morales the brother from La Bamba?
Oh, my gosh.
The drunk brother?
Yes. You're right, dude.
Is he? Oh, man. It was so hard for me to, like, take him legit because all I could keep thinking is, was he in La Bamba?
Guess what? His name is Ezi Morales, and his character's name is Bob Morales. Yeah, you're right. Nice.
Huh, okay.
It's a deep cut. Yeah,
that was just one puzzle that I was trying to put together.
1987, deep cut from Sack Lunch.
One more puzzle, because okay. This one genuinely confused me. I thought the fact that Kittredge was on the train at the end made him a bad person. But his last interaction with Ethan Hunt seemed like Ethan was going, hey, keep supporting us. You're doing great. Am I wrong?
I think it's multi-layered. So this is how I took it.
Okay.
I think they introduced him as a somewhat bad character, one that we don't like because he kind of screwed over Ethan in the first film. Even though he wasn't the bad guy, he just wasn't a very good judge of character. Like he thought Ethan was the bad guy, so he was all up in his business. So they introduced him as kind of an antagonistic type character. And I think his arc was like, you know, we want this AI so that we can have control, just like the White Widow wanted it. And just so that the U.S. government had power over the rest of the world, you know, I think that's what his motivation was. But I think also Ethan Hunt knew that in order to save Haley, her name's Grace.
Grace. Yeah.
Grace, Haley Atwell. In order to save her, because he only had that one person shoot to get out, escape. He was like, you need to attach yourself to this guy. He might be a little greasy, but he will, if you spin it in a way that like he wants you as an asset, play it that way so that you don't die. Cause I don't think Kittredge is, his intentions are not as pure as Ethan Hunt's.
Right. Ethan Hunt's are global. Kittredge is domestic. Best way to think about it.
And
United States.
Keep his career intact.
Yeah. Okay. All right.
So that's
I'm with that.
That's how I kind of saw it at the end.
I don't know if this transitions into Popcorn Redemption or if it's in puzzles. So I'm going to throw this out there.
This could be a transition.
Popcorn transition. I feel like this movie, and this might actually add some like bite to Tom Cruise saying that this is the last one. I felt like this was an homage to 1 through 6.
Mm-hmm.
Like the scene where they were where they were getting redirected, that reminded me where Cruise fought the Paris and you know, they fought on the bridge. That scene kind of reminded me of the opening scene of this entire franchise, mm-hmm. where they kind of died. And then when they were in the desert, that kind of reminded me of the scenes where we talked about what was in Fallout,
mm-hmm.
where they were in Dubai.
No, that was
Ghost Protocol.
Ghost Protocol.
I thought that was really, really great. So I feel like over and over they were taking seeds from previous and not trying to copy them, but pay homage. Because there was even one where he was in Rome and he said something in this movie. He said, she says, I've never driven here. And he says, me either. But if you remember in Fallout,
they were in Paris. They were in Rome.
But
it's similar. They were at the Arc de Triomphe.
But it's similar.
They were driving around.
That's what I'm trying to say.
Yeah.
Exactly. Is the scenes were just so much of this is what we love about the franchise.
It's like, I love chocolate cake, but if you can give me a cool way, a different way to eat it or a new recipe, I'm going to enjoy it because I like chocolate cake. You know what I'm saying? Like it's cool in that way. And I do agree. There was a lot of nods to the other films and other characters, like subtle ones, even Angela Bassett's character, because she couldn't be in the film. They have a picture of her in the office as the old director. Like there's some really cool, it's all bringing it together. And I think it might be true that there's not going to be any more of these.
Yeah. I just thought that it was so great how they did that.
Agreed. All right. That's a great segue into Redemption. Obviously Popcorn Redemption is built so that we can end on a high note. So we're not just complaining about a film. If it sucks, we can always find something good to say. And that's what I want to leave with you. Popcorn Redemption.
I have exorcised the demons.
All right. So I have three redemptions, and then I want to get to our rating, where we would rank this with the other films. And that will be it for Dead Reckoning Part 1. All right, the first one is Dead Reckoning is one of several summer movies in 2023 that's actually just a part one of a bigger story. So I haven't seen these other two movies. I would like to see them because I love movies, but I haven't seen them yet. And I know that they have pretty big cliffhangers. So one is Across the Spider-Verse and Fast X. And while there's plenty more story to come in part two of Mission Impossible, it was Cruz who was particularly adamant that this film have its own ending. Quote, Tom was fixated day and night on the ending of the movie, says Q. He had great anxiety about the end of the film, that the end of part one was going to be a cliffhanger, and that cliffhangers by their very nature tend to be deeply, deeply unsatisfying. You feel like the camera just stopped and you're not there. You're not giving that release. I have to wait a year? I have to wait 2 years for whatever that release is? Cue the reveal that Ethan has the key. Mission accomplished. And that part two will be all about heading to the very thing it unlocks.
Boy, that's a great point.
And he says, quote, we got to give them that sense of completion, and yet the story has to feel like it needs a place to go. Brilliant.
God, so well done.
Yeah, brilliant on Cruz's part. Like, he understands that that's not cool as a viewer, as a consumer of the media. Like, I don't love giant matzo balls hanging out there, man.
No, and I couldn't understand why. Like, again, I mentioned last week that I didn't love that. I kind of felt like, oh, wait a minute, this can't be over. But I think it was for two reasons. Number one, it was so good that I wanted to continue to watch, even though I probably needed a little bit of a break. But,
intermission.
But it did make it okay for me. I did feel complete enough. So that was brilliant. I didn't even realize why I felt that way. And that just summed it up.
Yeah, I've read a lot about this animated Spider-Man movie where you get to the end and you're like, you're kind of angry that you got to wait 2 years to figure out what happens next. Like, you can do cliffhangers in like TV shows when you got to wait a week or something. That's cool anticipation, but not years, man. Don't do that to a viewer. That's mean. Mean spirited.
Okay.
So that's my redemption is I think Cruz, thank you. I know you're listening. Thanks. You're correct. Again, second to last one is, this is what I was telling you about. I looked up all of the stuff that Tom Cruise knows how to do. This is really cool. Flying planes, helicopters across continents, to performing heart-stopping stunts on motorbikes and parachutes, Cruise has an extensive repertoire of skills honed over years of rigorous training and emphasis on rigorous. His impressive list of licenses include commercial pilot certificates for single-engine and multi-engine fixed-wing airplanes, and he's a type-rated Honda jet pilot. However, his skill set doesn't stop at traditional aircraft. Cruz is also authorized to fly experimental aircraft, such as the Albatross L-39 jet and the NP-51 Mustang. He's an honorary U.S. naval aviator. He's taken his love He's taken his love for flight to thrilling new heights, training in helicopter aerobatics and landing in the most challenging terrains, from confined mountainous areas to deep snow. He's also a Nitrox certified advanced diver, an expert free diver, and a skilled stunt driver and motorcycle rider. For Dead Reckoning Part 1, Cruz adds another feather to his cap by setting the record for the most jumps off of a cliff on a motorcycle and becoming trained and competent in base, not free base jumping, but base jumping. It's a callback to last week. And his commitment to his craft and his audience knows no bounds.
Incredible. Goat.
When you told me the first time you're like, Tom Cruise is the GOAT, I was like, at first I was like, he's awesome, but he's not the GOAT. And then you sit back and think about it and you're like, he is. There's no one like him in the industry.
No. There's not, dude. There's truly not. There's a lot of truly accomplished people, but there's not another Tom Cruise. He is the GOAT.
He is. And my last redemption is just general about the movie. So I love the masks. I love them. And I love that we get more of them in this movie. It's so great. I love the running. That scene where he's running on the top of the airport. It's...
Yeah.
I mean... It can't, how could running on a roof be breathtaking? It is. And I just love it.
It is.
What a brilliant location to have him run on that specific area on the roof. It's just beautiful. I love Ving Rhames. I love that he's in this. I love it that we get a lot with him, a lot of dialogue with him. I love the stunts. I love the train sequence. The fight scene in the alleyway is very cool. The motorcycle jump. I mean, it was just great.
I couldn't agree more. And just to add to the list, there was a lot of humor in this that didn't take away from the action, that didn't stop the action, that didn't disrupt the movie, didn't change the feel of it, and enhanced it. Mm-hmm. The humor in this one was so good, man.
It was really
so good.
Yeah. And Simon Pegg is a good proponent of that, too.
Absolutely. And this one, above all the other ones, it felt like was that they all, the synergy between the characters was truly elevated in this one.
Yeah.
And you could really feel the familiarity between the characters. And even from an acting standpoint, you could see the respect that each of them had for each other.
I agree.
There were some gut-wrenching moments in the movie. And I just feel like it delivered everything that you would want from an action film.
Yeah. Are you okay with the deaths? There's a couple characters that die.
Yeah, I think you kind of had to.
I agree.
These guys have 9 lives. And if this is the last installment, this is a dirty business that they're in. And inevitably, it's going to happen.
Well, and it also gives, every time in a movie that some big character dies, it gives the hero that motivation. You know, it sets the tone for there's a lot of risk. Hey, we can't all live. We might not live through this. And it heightens the tension for the viewer. Like, yeah, it sucks. Like, I really would like Tom Cruise or Ethan Hunt to, I know you hate the fact that he got married, but like, I would love that if he could have a beer sometime and just relax for a minute. But, you know, maybe he can't. Maybe he can't. He just can't.
Remember that at the end of Ghost Protocol, he has a beer.
True.
So.
Yeah. So it's there. But. All right. Any other redemption?
Yeah. I just think overall, you kind of nailed it. Not just with the airport scene. All the visuals were incredible. The action was truly just heart pounding, and it was such a comfortable place for me to be in, being back in the theater and watching this type of movie. Like, this is what movies are, man.
Yeah. And it's funny because I know you're not a Marvel fan. I am a Marvel fan, but at the same time, like, I don't get fatigued with these movies like I do with the Marvel movies. I don't know why. I have more anticipation for something like this. Maybe it's because the frequency is less and there's more anticipation for it. I don't know. I'm always looking forward to these films with Tom Cruise.
I completely agree with that. And I think that's a testament to Tom Cruise as well.
Yeah.
Being the GOAT.
Making it an event. Like, this is something you want to experience and go with friends and hate, you know, experience it.
Yeah. And this is a movie that I will absolutely watch again.
Yeah, me too. All All right, that brings us to our rating. This was really hard for me, as it was when I was ranking the other six. I don't know, you might be taken aback by where I put this. And here's why. Before I tell you where it slots into the seven slots, because there's no ties here. This isn't soccer or football. It felt, so if I'm comparing it to, let's say, Fallout, the last film. Fallout was this like a roller coaster and cotton candy and like, you know, awesome ice cream. And it's so super fun. And you kind of get, it's like guilty. You're like, I want some more of this ice cream. I know it might make me sick a little bit, but I'm going to eat more of it. This one felt more, had a more heavy tone, and it felt more, it still had all those elements, but it was more, I don't know how to put it. It was more grown up, I guess, or more
meaningful.
Meaningful, sophisticated, and it was a little
more
different.
Impactful.
Yeah, there was some gravitas to what was going on and all the interaction between all the different characters and the faceless entity that they're fighting. So it was different. It was a different feel to me, but still maintained a Mission Impossible overall feel. With that being said, I'm putting this at number three.
Really? Okay.
Yeah, I Fallout for me is always going to be at the top. It's so good, man. It's so fun, and I can watch it. I could watch it and then push play again and watch it through a second time. There's very few movies that I can do that. And then Ghost Protocol stays at number two, then Dead Reckoning, then MI1, MI3. Rogue Nation and MI2 is seventh. Where do you put this? Does it make top three?
Yeah, I won't go through all mine, but you know that my least favorite is three.
Yeah.
And my top is two. And it just so happened my wife flipped through two last night, and it reminded me how much I love that freaking movie.
It's good.
It's so good. But this one bumped them all. It is the top.
Oh, it bumped MI2.
It did, man.
I thought you were not going to like it as much.
Can I just spoiler the very end?
Oh, we're in spoilers.
Not of the movie, of the podcast.
Oh, I don't know. Yeah, what is the very end? This is the end.
I'm giving this a golden bucket.
Oh, my gosh. That's insane. I gave Fallout a golden bucket. I was only going to give it a large bucket, but dude, I felt the same way.
We're going double gold here?
Double gold, bro. Looking at my list, my seven, the top three are golden buckets for me. Easily. Fallout, Ghost Protocol, Dead Reckoning, golden buckets.
I've been stingy with them, but this one felt great to utter those words.
That's awesome. I wasn't expecting that.
It just had everything for me. And you know that I'm big on nostalgia and these movies that harken back to certain moments in my life. This was an experience for me and one that I'm always going to remember. I'm not giving a golden bucket just because it was my first movie experience in Brazil and first one with my wife, you know,
true.
First movie theater. And we haven't went out on many dates over the last couple of years, you know, I just felt comfortable in the movie seat watching this movie.
Yeah.
And it's because of everything that we talked about up to this point that put me in that nostalgic. This is why I love the movie theater. Right, because Top Gun, I did that for everybody else, but I didn't get to experience that in the movie theater.
Mm-hmm.
In fact, I had to watch most of that on my phone.
Oh,
so
I just got a really big pain in my stomach.
I did. I watched that on my phone, brother. So it was so awesome, man.
It's so good,
so awesome, and so relevant to today. And just again, the way they paid an homage to every other one to me.
I feel like that was intentional. I've never heard any interviews or anything like that, but I whether it was conscious or subconscious, I do feel like it was conscious and it was intentional. It was just great, man. Like, I walked out of there wanting more, and that's what you want out of a movie. That's like, if you're walking out going, God, give me more. And it sucks that I've got to wait a year, but at the same time, that's just going to build that anticipation. Again, Tom Cruise is the GOAT, and just getting to see him do what he does in what might be one of his final movies like this, to this level with this much action, because again, he can't do it forever.
Yeah.
Again, it's not something that is life altering or anything like that, but this is what movies are for.
Just from a pure entertainment standpoint, like, you're not going to change your paradigm of life. It's just a pure entertainment.
Look, I've got a lot of things going on, you know, that I've got a 2-year-old. I work a full-time job. I have a extremely fast paced growing business that I own. I live in another country. I'm dealing with immigration. I'm doing all of this stuff. I've got a family member who's fallen ill. There's so many things that are going on, but for that 2 hours and 48 minutes, I was dialed in, man. And it was Tom Cruise and the crew that it was the crew's gazing that did that for me. And so this was absolutely a golden bucket.
That's awesome, dude. Yeah. And do you feel like there's in the reviews that I had to read, a lot of them, there was a lot of people hating on the plot. Like, I didn't feel like it was confusing at all. I felt like it was easy to follow. I loved the idea of the AI being part of the villain. I thought all that was great and added to the story and the overall enjoyment of the film. And to your point about the characters, like, I think that a lot of care was taken over the last 20 years or however long this has been going on, more than 20 years, to set up for this movie and be able to weave all those characters together. It felt really nice.
I don't understand why anybody would say it was hard to follow. And I think that goes back to, like, you remember back in the day when It's in the Cloud was so confusing to people.
Yeah.
I think AI is similar to cloud. Like, just the word AI and the cloud, I think, are synonymous with causing confusion. Yeah. Because this was pretty straightforward. It was basically saying, hey, this AI is sentient, has basically come alive, and now we've got to find a way to shut it down. And it's everywhere. Like, we all know it's everywhere. I say this all the time. Like, can you imagine, especially in the United States, trying to get away with a murder now? How do you do it? Your car tracks everywhere you're going. Everybody's got a Ring doorbell. There's cameras absolutely everywhere. Your car has it's tracked every single place that it goes. So this is AI. This is what it is. So I don't understand why people would be confused by it.
Yeah, it's baffling to me, but that's awesome. I feel good. Feels good.
I do too. Absolutely.
Any parting thoughts for part one? We'll be back in a year. It's going to be a bit, but you gotta do it.
Just get out there and see this movie, support this movie, because it clearly got a bad luck of the draw with a couple of things that are taking place around it that we referenced last week.
Yeah.
So
it's a bummer.
You know, even now, like, get out there. And look, my theater was full. I'm sure yours was, because you saw it super early, but I saw it pretty late, right? A couple of weeks into the release. So, and the theater was full, which was great. And I hope that people continue to go out and support it. And, I think that's it.
Yeah, I hope that maybe there's a little drop off of all the crazies that are going to Barbenheimer, and that they go back and check out Mission Impossible. Maybe there's a second wind for it before it leaves the theater.
Yeah, let's hope.
All right, dude. Man, this theme song's so dope.
That's so good, man. What a journey.
What a journey. That's it for this week. but I'm with you always. Look for me in the cloud at Popcorn Priest. I love movies and would love it if you would share the love. Share this with the movie lover in your life. Another way to support the show is by throwing a few shekels at the priest by visiting patreon.com/popcornpriest and see what extra perks you can enjoy. If you made it this far through all these pods with us, give us a 5-star review on Spotify or Apple Podcasts. Or if you can't, tell us what you think you would change, and we'll take it into consideration. As always, thanks for listening, and thanks to my reoccurring guest, Dan, IMF Agent Sekulich. Always a pleasure, my man.
It absolutely is. Keep doing what you do. Keep loving it. Keep doing it with the same passion. I appreciate you letting me be a part of it, brother.
Yeah, dude, it's awesome. And for the listeners, if you guys have any suggestions for us to watch, if there's something that you want us to review, just hit me up on the Instagram and we'll put it on the list.
Yeah.
Remember, when you watch movies, you can pop off, pop in, or pop out, but always bring the popcorn.